As you might have heard, there was a recent controversy involving the SPF rating of some Korean sunscreens. This led many people, especially abroad, to look down on Korean sunscreens and Korean beauty as a whole. So, as a marketing professional that works with the Korean beauty market, today I decided I want to take you through how sunscreens are regulated in Korea and why some of the sunscreens involved in this controversy were not really FDA approved as the brands claimed they were. Hello and welcome. If you're new to my channel, my name is Odile and I work in cosmetic marketing and advertising for Asian Pacific countries with a special focus on South Korea and China. I've been personally researching the Korean beauty industry for over a decade. And on my channel, I use my professional experience to bring you informative content on Korean beauty trends and history. But before we start, I must thank two other professionals that kindly accepted to consult me for this video. And they are Giulio Pirotta, who has more than 30 years of experience working as a regulatory specialist for beauty companies and is also the author of a paper called An Overview of Sunscreen Regulations Around the World. The other person is someone who worked for 11 years on product development, research and regulatory for one of the two biggest beauty groups in Korea. He asked to remain anonymous, but for the sake of this video, let's just call him Mr. Lee. Having said that, this video is quite complex, so I decided to divide it in different parts to make it easier for you to follow. And you will also find all original sources in the description box below. Part 1. What happened? In December 2020, the founder of the website Inky Decoder published a blog post to announce they commissioned two independent European labs to investigate the UV protection of a popular Korean sunscreen alcohol P. Both labs found that sunscreen P had an SPF rating of 19, which was way lower than the SPF 50+ advertised on the packaging of the product. Towards the end of December, the CEO of the Korean Institute of Dermatological Science, which is one of the cosmetic inspection agencies officially appointed by the Korean government, published a video on YouTube and revealed that, according to the tests, sunscreen P had an SPF rating of 28, and five other Korean sunscreens that were supposed to provide an SPF 50 protection were actually tested to be less than SPF 30. In a second video posted a few weeks later, the same CEO revealed that another Korean SPF 50 sunscreen was tested to be less than SPF 30. Despite not being included in any of these videos, more Korean sunscreens came under scrutiny for having similar formulas and sharing the same manufacturing company of the other incriminated sunscreens. This sparked an international controversy around Korean sunscreens and the Korean beauty industry as a whole, with many people questioning the quality and safety of Korean cosmetics. Part 2. The aftermath. Despite being a Korean product, sunscreen P was created by a brand that is mostly unknown in their home country. So the controversy didn't blow up in Korea until the CEO of the Korean Institute of Dermatological Science published a first video. After the video, many Korean consumers went online to express their anger and frustration, especially because some of the sunscreens involved in this scandal were topping the rankings of WAE, the most popular beauty app in Korea that is centered around the concept of consumer transparency. Following this outrage, all the sunscreens involved were recalled from the market, and most companies said they would investigate the issue. In the meantime, some Korean consumers organized through a website called Angry People. And with the help of the law firm Warden, In March 2021, they filed a class action against the manufacturing companies that produced the sunscreens and the brands that sold them. At the moment, the Korean authorities are still investigating. But if the involved parties are found guilty, they could face up to 1 year of imprisonment or a fine of around $9,000. This is according to Article 37 of the Korean Cosmetic Act. Part 3. How beauty products are made. To understand what went wrong with these sunscreens, first you need to have a basic understanding of how beauty products are made. When a brand wants to launch a new product, there are three approaches they can take. They can formulate and produce the product in-house. This is the most expensive approach because it requires a company to have their own research and development team, their own formulators, their own production facilities, and all the staff that comes with them. For this reason, this approach is not usually an option for small indie brands, unless they have significant financial backing. 2. They can formulate the product in-house, but outsource production to an external company. This kind of company is called OEM, short for Original Equipment Manufacturer. This approach is a little more affordable because the OEM provides the production facilities and the staff to look after them. Plus, with this approach, the brand retains the intellectual property of the product, meaning that the OEM is not allowed to sell the same formula to a competitor brand. 3. They can outsource the formulation and the production of the product to an external company. This type of company is called ODM, short for Original Design Manufacturer. This is the most affordable approach, and it's usually the one used by most small, medium-sized companies. Sometimes brands pay for ready-made formulas developed by the ODM. Sometimes they request specific adjustments or personalizations. Either way, the intellectual property of the product belongs to the ODM. This means that the ODM is allowed to sell the same formula to a competitor brand. This practice is sometimes referred to as private labeling. These approaches are not exclusive to Korean beauty. I worked for beauty brands both in Europe and in Asia, and I can tell you that the main difference between the two markets is that in Europe there are only a handful of manufacturing companies, meaning that most European cosmetics are actually made by the same people. Whereas in Asia, and in Korea in particular, there are a lot more companies and brands have more choice. Part 4. Sunscreen regulations in Korea. In Korea, beauty products are regulated by the Cosmetic Act. According to this law, cosmetic products are classified in two main categories: general cosmetics and functional cosmetics. Article 2 of the Cosmetic Act defines functional cosmetics as cosmetics with specific functions like brightening skin, improving wrinkles, or protecting skin from UV rays, for example. Unlike general cosmetics, functional cosmetics are subject to what is called pre-market approval, meaning that before a brand is allowed to sell a product to the general public, the formula of that product should be approved by the Korean Ministry of Food and Drug Safety. For convenience, I'll just call them the MFDS. When a company requests the MFDS to evaluate a functional cosmetic product, they must submit a dossier that confirms the safety, efficacy, and function of the product according to the testing standards recognized by the Korean law in what is called the Korean Functional Cosmetic Codex. This means that the MFDS doesn't test products. They simply review test results that are submitted to them. So, who's in charge of testing these products? Testing and inspection agencies that are officially appointed by the Korean authorities. and the Korean Institute of Dermatological Science that I mentioned at the beginning of this video is one of them. When a brand formulates a product in-house, they are responsible to contact an authorized testing agency to get the product tested, and later submit the results to the MFDS to get pre-market approval. In case it's an ODM that formulates the product, they are responsible for the entire process, and a brand has no choice but to trust that the ODM is working properly. Now, when it comes to requesting approval for a product that is supposed to protect the skin from UV rays, a company is required to send the MFDS test results that confirm the SPF rating of the product, the PA rating, and whether or not the product is water resistant. But what testing methods are used in South Korea? According to Article 5 of the Standards of Functional Cosmetics Evaluation, for SPF measurement, the MFDS accepts the JCIA method used in Japan, the American FDA method, the CLEPA method from Europe, the ASNTS method used in Australia and New Zealand, and the international ISO standards. For PA measurement, which indicates the protection against UVB rays, Korea only accepts the JCIA method from Japan. For water resistance, Korea accepts the standards set by the American FDA, the CLEPA method from Europe, and the ASNTS used in Australia and New Zealand. The Korean authorities decided to accept all these different standards with the aim of making Korean beauty more competitive on an international scale. For example, if a Korean brand wants to advance in the American market, testing their products using the American standards is going to make the export process a lot quicker and a lot easier. Every single sunscreen in Korea has to go through this pre-market approval process, with one exception. And this is very important for the purpose of this video. According to Article 10 of the Enforcement Rule of the Cosmetics Act, some functional cosmetics can be exempt from pre-market approval as long as they're similar to a product that was already approved by the MFDS, with only minor changes. In particular, the new product must contain the same active ingredients and in the same quantity as the approved product, must have the same efficacy and effect of the approved product. In the case of UV rating, a discrepancy of up to -20% is accepted. Must have been produced following the same standards and testing methods of the approved product. Must have the same use and the same capacity of the approved product. Must have the same type of formulation of the approved product. In this context, creams, solutions, and lotions are considered equivalent. This law might seem a little odd, but you have to keep in mind that companies have to pay a fee every time they submit a request to the MFDS. Plus, the time frame to get the product approved is 60 days. So this exception was created to help companies that wanted to launch a big range of products with almost identical formulas. A good example would be foundations that also provide UV protection. Usually a company would have to submit a different request for each shade in the range, but thanks to this law, the process is quicker, easier, and cheaper. One last thing about Korean regulations before we move on. The MFDS also performs randomized post-market checks to make sure that the products that are currently sold on the market are up to standard. Every couple of days, they share a list of violations they found, with the name of the incriminated products, the brands that make them, and the penalties. And if you follow me on Twitter, you probably know this already, because I always make sure to share the most serious incidents. Part 5. What went wrong? Before I start breaking down what really happened behind the scenes, you need to know that almost all sunscreens involved in this controversy were formulated and manufactured by two ODMs. For convenience, I'll call them ODM 1 and ODM 2. When confronted with the evidence that their products failed to meet the SPF 50 claim, all these brands came out with statements on how the SPF rating of their products was officially approved by the Korean authorities, and therefore, any discrepancies should have been blamed on the Korean regulations and not on them as companies. Let me tell you that, as someone who has first-hand experience of the approval process of sunscreens in Korea, when I read those statements, I was like, no. I mean, don't get me wrong, sometimes things go south and sunscreen testing is very complex, as you might know if you watched this video from Lab Muffin Beauty Science. But for these many sunscreens to fail to meet label claims while being produced by the same two ODMs? Well, it turns out that the Korean press had the same gut feeling I had. And in January 2021, the professional cosmetic industry website Cosmorning published an article on the controversy. In the article, they wrote that they contacted ODM 1, which is the original manufacturer of sunscreen P, to ask them about why the product was tested to be less than SPF 30. And this is what they had to say. The different SPF values, which have been controversial, are considered an issue related to the process of improving the applicability of the initial formula. And according to the standards and testing methods of functional cosmetics, there's no obligation to perform a new SPF evaluation if the main ingredient and formulation type are not changed. After the formulation was changed, we tried to conduct additional tests internally, but it was hard to achieve consistent results of the SPF index. So we consulted with the brand and ceased production. Plus, Cosmorning also interviewed the CEO of the official inspection agency that allegedly tested the product for pre-market approval. And they stated, "We have not conducted a test evaluation of the product with the related issue." A few days later, another cosmetic industry website called CNC News managed to get the statement from the brand that commissioned sunscreen P. And this is what they wrote in an article on their website. "The problem stems from the fact that the product was first developed as a cream formula and later changed to a lotion with improved application and spreadability. The SPF value on the label refers to the cream, since no additional tests were performed." When it comes to sunscreen K, which was formulated and manufactured by ODM 1 as well, the brand that commissioned the product published this picture on their website to prove to the customers that the sunscreen was tested to be SPF 50. Now, unless you are a beauty industry professional who has first-hand experience of the approval process of sunscreens in Korea, you might think that this is a test result from a testing lab, and it's not. This is the form that a company has to submit when they want to apply for an exemption from pre-market review, according to the rules set by Article 10. And it's easy to verify, because this is a guide compiled by the Korean authorities to show companies how to apply for an exemption from pre-market approval of functional cosmetics. And as you can see, the form is exactly the same. Plus, if you see this tiny text right here, it says date of the examination of the product that was previously approved. And from this we can tell that the brand behind the sunscreen K applied for a pre-market approval exemption, and sunscreen K was never really reviewed by an official inspection agency or the MFDS. Lastly, ODM2, which is the company that formulated and manufactured sunscreen R and sunscreen H, sent two letters to the brand that commissioned them sunscreen R. In the first one of these letters, they cite Article 10 of the Enforcement Rule of the Cosmetics Act, which is the article I talked about before that says that products can be exempt from pre-market review as long as they present the same characteristics of a product that was already approved by the MFDS. In the second letter, the ODM goes on to reveal the name of the original product that was approved by the MFDS, meaning that the formula of sunscreen R was created on the basis of another product that received the approval of the Korean authorities. And since they quote Article 10, we can assume sunscreen R was never submitted for review after the formula has been tweaked with. I know this might be a little overwhelming, so I'll try to sum it up quickly. ODM 1 and ODM 2 originally created two cream formulas for sunscreens that provided a UV protection of SPF 50+. These two sunscreens were tested by an official inspection agency approved by the Korean authorities, which confirmed their SPF rating. And this was enough for the Ministry of Food and Drug Safety, what people usually call the Korean FDA, to approve the products to be sold on the market. After this approval, ODM 1 and ODM 2 decided to tweak the formula to improve application and thinning on the skin. And they tried to use a legal loophole to avoid pre-market review by the Korean authorities. In short, this scandal comes down to a handful of companies trying to use a loophole to avoid pre-market tests, only to point fingers at the Korean regulations when they got caught. When asked about the incident, a senior manager of the Korean Cosmetic Association commented, "We have tried to relieve regulations to guarantee industry autonomy. But in the case of more problems arising, it will be necessary to toughen the related regulations. At the moment, the MFDS is still investigating, and I will let you know if there are any updates." Part 6. What to do now? The thing that upsets me the most about this scandal is that the poor behavior of a handful of companies is overshadowing the hard work and effort of the vast majority of companies in this industry that play by the rules. With this video, I wanted you to understand that this kind of behavior represents an exception and not a rule. And even though regulations are in place, because they are, that doesn't prevent people from going around them. Now, I know that many of you might feel a little lost and confused at the moment, so I decided that I want to share with you the criteria that I use when I want to buy a Korean sunscreen. These tips are not 100% fail-proof, because as I mentioned earlier, formulation and testing of sunscreens are complicated, and sometimes things go wrong without the company even noticing it. That being said, there are some best practices that are based on the regulations and dynamics of the Korean market that I think it's helpful to keep in mind. The first thing you should know is that when you buy a Korean beauty product, whether it's a sunscreen or else, you're given an incredible power. Unlike in Europe or America, for example, in Korea, companies are legally required to disclose who formulated and who manufactured a product. If you check the packaging of any Korean beauty product, you will see these two texts. The first one means distributor. This tells you the name of the company that owns the brand you're buying from. The second text means manufacturer, and it's used to indicate the company that formulated the product and the company that produced it. If a product is formulated and manufactured by the same company, you will see only one name after this text. If a product is formulated in-house, the name of the manufacturer and the name of the distributor I mentioned before are usually the same. If a product is formulated and manufactured by an ODM, the name of the manufacturer and the name of the distributor will be different. When a product is formulated in-house but manufactured by an OEM, you will see first the name of the OEM, followed by the name of the beauty company that formulated the product, which is usually the same name as the distributor. If you can't read Korean, there are many apps nowadays that can help you translate text in photos. But sometimes you can also find this information in English on some online shops. How can you make the most of this information? My first advice when you in the market for a Korean sunscreen is to pick one that was formulated and manufactured in-house by the brand you buy from. The main Korean companies that formulate and manufacture almost all their products in-house are the LG Group and the Amore Pacific Group. There are two reasons for this. First, as I mentioned at the beginning of this video, in this case the company is responsible for the entire production process, from formulation to production, testing and pre-market approval. And this rules out the possibility of any external company messing up any part of this process or manipulating data, for example. The second reason is that only big companies can afford to formulate and manufacture their products entirely in-house. And since these companies have a wide market share, they're more frequently subject to the post-market checks conducted by the Korean authorities. And because the authorities are keeping a close eye on these companies, they're under a lot of pressure to play by the rules. My second tip is buying sunscreens that are produced by manufacturers that specialize in sunscreens. See, there are many manufacturing companies in Korea, and some of them are specialized for particular types of products. You got manufacturers that specialize in sheet masks, you got manufacturers that specialize in cleansers, and you got manufacturers that are famous for their sunscreens. The main sunscreen producer in Korea is widely considered to be Kolmar Korea, but there are also many others. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that other manufacturers are not reliable, but think of it in these terms. When you're in the market for a sports car, you go to Ferrari, you don't go to Kia. And this doesn't mean that Kia makes bad cars, because they don't. It simply means that sports cars are not their expertise. So it's unlikely that they would have the latest technology, the latest innovations, or the latest equipment, for example. I hope this clarifies everything you wanted to know on this scandal. If you have any other questions or doubts, don't hesitate to leave a comment below and I'll do my best to help. Please don't forget to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe for more informative content on Korean beauty. Thanks for watching and I'll see you next time.